The fact that you're watching this video probably means you already know about the Atlantic Meridional Overturning Circulation, or AMOC, and scientists' warnings that that system might slow down or even come to a halt at some point this century. You may even have heard those reports from me, because I've made several videos on that precise topic. The AMOC has become a bit of a poster child for the climate emergency in recent years, partly thanks to the ridiculously over-exaggerated Hollywood blockbuster The Day After Tomorrow, and partly because it lies slap bang in between the two most affluent continents on Earth, with a combined population of well over a billion people. The rest of the global thermohaline circulation, of which AMOC is just one component, generally gets much less attention, perhaps because it's mostly right down there near Antarctica, or out in the middle of the Indian and Pacific Oceans, and it just sort of keeps grinding away, doing its very important job of moving cold water southwards and bringing warm water north, while moving vital nutrients around our oceans to feed all the marine ecosystems. Well, at least it did do that until recently. Now, though, a new rather disturbing research paper has been published that suggests one of the components of the system right down there in the Southern Ocean has entered a new and entirely unexpected steady state. And trust me, folks, the words new and unexpected very rarely represent a welcome surprise when it comes to our changing climate. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. So the research paper I'm talking about is this one, published in late June 2025 in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences in the US. It focuses on a much less well-known system called the Southern Meridional Overturning Circulation, or SMOC, which can be found in the Southern Ocean. To get an idea of the significance of the SMOC, it's worth having a quick look at how it fits in alongside all the other parts of the thermohaline circulation, otherwise known as the Great Ocean Conveyor Belt. But before we get into that, if you're interested in this kind of content, then don't forget to subscribe to the channel and hit all notifications so you won't miss any of my weekly videos. So essentially, the thermohaline circulation, or THC, is driven by differences in temperature, which is the thermo part, and salinity, which is the haline part. Those two variables affect water density, which in turn drives vertical and horizontal movement of ocean waters around the globe. Up here, the warm, salty Gulf Stream waters coming across the Atlantic, driven mainly by the wind, hit the cold fresh waters of the Arctic region and sink down to about 3,000 metres, where they head south all the way down to Antarctica, and then either across into the Indian Ocean or into the Pacific, before eventually, after about 1,000 years or so, returning back up the western side of Africa and across into the Gulf of Mexico, where they join up with the warm Gulf waters and the whole thing goes round again. The point is, that circulation of heat, salinity, carbon and food has been a very stable system throughout the last 10 to 12,000 years or so, which means marine ecosystems and land-based life have all come to rely on its predictable patterns. And of course that includes us humans, which is why the findings of this latest research paper are a bit of a worry. Down there in the Southern Ocean, scientists have been observing the surface waters getting fresher for decades. And when I say fresher, I mean they've been getting less and less salty. No great surprises there, say the scientists. The world is warming and there's more moisture in the atmosphere. That means it's raining more, which tends to have a diluting effect on sea surface salinity levels. Fresh water is lighter, so it tends to float on top of heavier, saltier water, and that creates stratification or layering in the ocean, which keeps the warmer, deeper water from rising to the surface. And that's quite handy because trapping the heat in deeper ocean layers stops it from melting sea ice from below. So ironically, that stratification may well have contributed to sea ice expansion in the Antarctic region. The worrying bit, according to the paper's authors, is that since 2015, all that has started to change. Measurements indicate that the Southern Ocean surface waters have actually become saltier in the last decade, not fresher. That's weakened the layering effect and allowed the deeper, warmer water to move upwards. The result is a dramatic decline in sea ice in recent years, and perhaps even more alarmingly, the rising warm water is also bringing previously trapped carbon dioxide to the surface, where it can be transferred into our atmosphere. Now, if you're a keen watcher of YouTube climate science videos or an avid reader of those kinds of social media posts, you may have seen a rather clickbaity headline getting amplified all over the place this week, suggesting that these findings represent a dramatic reversal of the entire SMOC system. Well, it's certainly not an ideal situation, that's for sure, but calling it a reversal has turned out to be an entirely unnecessary exaggeration. In fact, that suggestion is just plain wrong. The misinformation all seems to have stemmed from this original summary article posted by the very organisation that published the research paper, a Barcelona-based science institute called the ICM-CSIC. To be clear, there's nothing wrong with the information in the research paper itself, just in the headline used to promote its publication. I don't think it was a deliberate attempt to mislead. I think it was more likely just a good old-fashioned cock-up. Anyway, that headline has now been changed, and a rather better summary of the paper's findings has now been provided by its lead author, Alessandro Silvano, for the online journal The Conversation. And I've linked that article in the description section below so you can go and have a read of it for yourself. Even without an earth-shattering flip in one of the major earth systems, though, this data is still pretty dramatic, and it probably wouldn't ever have been known about at all without some pretty cutting-edge technology. Apparently, the discovery was only made possible thanks to a key technical breakthrough developed by the Barcelona Expert Centre, or BEC, which is based at the ICM-CSIC Institute that I mentioned earlier. They specialise in satellite ocean observation, and they've developed a new data processor for the European SMOS satellite tailored to the geographical and climatic variability of the Southern Ocean, which had previously been inaccessible to satellites because of very low temperatures and the complex ever-changing dynamics of the sea ice. The researchers were able to combine those findings with data from some quite sophisticated and very robust underwater robots to build the overall 15-year picture of changes in ocean salinity, temperature, and sea ice. Interviewed in the amended IMC article, postdoctoral researcher Veronica Gonzalez said, "The new processor has allowed us to obtain surface salinity data of unprecedented quality in this region. Thanks to this improvement, we can now provide a coherent explanation for the rapid Antarctic sea ice loss that had puzzled the scientific community." Now, of course, it's great that modern technology is enabling scientific researchers to take increasingly accurate measurements of oceanic phenomena like this one, using multiple sources of analysis that can be cross-referenced to increase confidence in their overall accuracy. And it's good that there now seems to be some observable rationale for that sea ice decrease that we just looked at. What this new technology doesn't do, unfortunately, is tell us unequivocally what's caused the new regime to have come about in the first place. Scientists were expecting the Southern Ocean to keep getting fresher, not just as a result of the additional rainfall, but also because of more melting ice from Antarctica and an increased movement of fresh water toward the equator. So the fact that salinity has increased, not decreased, has got the scientists a bit stumped. It suggests that there are additional ocean processes at play here that we've not yet fully understood. Best guess, according to our oceanographers, is that the ocean is no longer simply responding to external influences, but is now starting to change its own behaviour, if you like, especially how it mixes and holds heat, setting up a self-reinforcing feedback loop. And if, like me, you've been discovering some of the consequences of self-reinforcing climate feedback loops in recent years, you'll know that they're about as welcome as the contents of Chevy Chase's hand.
What's this? You don't want it!
So, in summary then, while the entire SMOC system has not suddenly reversed, which really would have been absolutely catastrophic, this new scientific research nevertheless suggests it may be entering a new phase where sea ice stays low for the long term. That could affect the entire global climate because Antarctic sea ice plays a major role in reflecting sunlight and regulating heat across the planet. It could also mean rapid changes to marine ecosystems that they are simply not set up to cope with. And it will likely have an impact on the entire thermohaline circulation, including the AMOC system. In his summary for The Conversation, Alessandro Silvano says this, Antarctica is no longer the stable, frozen continent we once believed it to be. It is changing rapidly, and in ways that current climate models didn't foresee. The whole thing was summed up rather nicely by another researcher at the Barcelona Institute, Estrella Almeida, who said this: "The planet is sending us increasingly clear signals that we are crossing critical thresholds, and in this case, it's done so from a remote corner of the world that's very difficult to monitor, the Southern Ocean. Thanks to satellites and cutting-edge observation tools, we can now see what was once invisible." "We need to keep watching," says Alessandro Silvano, "yet ongoing satellite and ocean monitoring is threatened by funding cuts. This research offers us an early warning signal, a planetary thermometer, and a strategic tool for tracking a rapidly shifting climate. Without accurate, continuous data, it'll be impossible to adapt to the changes in store." Time for our dear leaders to wake up and smell the coffee, eh? Although if I had a pound for every time I've said that on this channel over the years, I'd have 37 pounds. I went back and checked. Anyway, time to express your view. I'm sure you're champing at the bit to do that. So whether you think it's all a load of old codswallop, for reasons best known to yourself, or if you think everything's gone well past the point of no return, or even if you have other opinions that you feel we should all know about, the place to leave your thoughts, as always, is in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. If you found this video useful and informative, then please do consider subscribing to the channel and clicking on all notifications so that you won't miss any of my weekly episodes. And you can also join the amazing group of folks over at Patreon who keep the lights on around here and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. I must also give a special thank you to the folks whose names are scrolling up the screen beside me here, all of whom celebrate an anniversary of Patreon support in July. You can have a look at what we all get up to there by going to patreon.com/justeverthink, or by following the link in the description section below, or if you're watching on a tablet, smartphone, PC or Mac, you can get there by clicking this link, and you can subscribe to the channel absolutely for free by clicking here. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.